started, if you could stay on the schedule for the day, and I also know some of you have appointments, so we're going to try to keep to our schedule. Thank you so much for being with us. Day three of bringing the community together at the South End to talk about how we shape our future. And for those of us, for those of you who were with us last night, it was wonderful to have the poets and writers and visionaries talking about how they reflect upon their ideas and their dreams about what the South End can be. And today we're going to continue a little bit more of that dreaming, but put a little touch of reality into it. We are so proud to have, as part of the Goody Clancy team, Susan Silberg also has an organization called Civic Moxie. My gosh, it's my favorite word. If you steal anything, Susan's going to kick off the day, and we'll also have another opportunity to work with Susan this afternoon at 2 o'clock in a roundtable discussion. And so I hope those of you who are here now are able to return or to send a friend to be with us in the afternoon. I mean, I think that's it. And we've been saying to everyone who's been a part of this process, please bring somebody here that wouldn't naturally come so that we can really bring in a lot of new voices to this process. Thank you for sticking with us. I think you're going to love this morning. Susan,
hi. Good morning, everyone. I love to, I think Noah's coming to Boston. you know, Dory just said something that I think it kind of wraps up approaching how to preserve, grow, sustain an arts culture someplace, innovation culture, maker culture, to kind of bring a friend. And I think at the end of that, what that's about is collaborate. And it's going to take a lot of people and different expertise and experiences to make this work in the way that's sustainable and really successful. So I think the bring a friend thing is a good thing. I'm going to talk for just a short amount of time about some of the things nationally around arts districts, innovation districts, and where they are, and where they really overlap. What are some of the common characteristics? Because the enterprise zone here has many of the characteristics of an innovation district. It's not called that. Innovation district is the buzzword right now for these things, but it is where they are. So taking a look at that, and then looking at how do you achieve sustainability of these districts, which is on everyone's mind, I think. And then we have some people for a panel who worked on various spaces, maker spaces and art spaces, to talk a little bit about the challenges and the experiences of that. So I'm going to start really by talking about innovation districts and arts districts, what makes them tick. This is a definition from the Brookings Institution report last summer, which really was kind of cutting edge of what these districts are. There are new complementary urban model emerging. They're geographic areas where leading edge, cutting edge technology, mix of uses coming together in startups and entrepreneurial ways come together to create, to make, to grow. They tend to be physically compact. They're transit accessible in cities, technically wired, and they offer a mix of different kinds of uses. It's really a departure from the old model, which may have been an industrial district, all kind of single use. Let's put the noxious uses on the side. Or the research park, which is, you know, the buildings out in the suburbs where we're going to do our research. Innovation district is pulling all of those things together, all of those uses in one compact place. And that departure from traditional economic development means that there's less emphasis on the kind of commercial aspects of the development in terms of there's less thinking about these are retail, sports stadiums, housing, and more focus on the firms, the thought process, the thought leadership, and the innovation, rather than the types of those commercial aspects. And it's really a coming together. This is a graphic from the Brookings Institution report. The physical, the networking, and the person-to-person, and then also the economic assets come together in these districts. So they're kind of socially and physically engineered in that way. It's about sectors that drive this broad-based prosperity. It's not about isolating, it's about this physical kind of mix-up. There's been a lot of work done on remixing spaces as places. I like the term mix-up because it fits really well with innovation and with arts and culture. And it's really an intentional effort to produce, to create new products, new ideas. It fits pretty well with our notion of what arts and cultural areas are. Arts districts, and sometimes the word cultural district is used, I'm going to stay away from that in this case, and we can talk about why later. Arts district is a demarcated urban area where there's a concentration of arts production, consumption, and collaboration. Artists' workspaces, work-live spaces, theaters, galleries, all of the things, and then the support pieces that go into supporting that culture. It includes cultural facilities, individual artists, art-based businesses. They tend to have very unique characters when they're authentic and not kind of top-down driven. They really are a vehicle to support and assist marketing artists' work, helping them to thrive as businesses. And they also can be a focal point for branding a community and kind of helping the identity of a community. And they can have formal boundaries or informal boundaries. So sometimes arts districts are not formally named and can be very kind of amorphous, or they can be formally designated, which tends to be the trend these days. So what are the common things between them? And I think this is where it's interesting. This is a list of some of the common things that you see in both of those places. And I'd like to go through a few. Creativity and innovation, those spaces that create that. This is an art space in Minneapolis that was a winner of the MetLife Innovative Space Awards a few years ago, Open Book, which is an innovative use that look at publishing and the writing arts. So there's a publishing house. There's support for writers, there are open workshops, there's open space for people to come together, and very different kinds of uses, printing house within the building, coming together in very innovative ways that haven't been done before, and really set a model around the country for the literary arts. There's collaboration, and what are the spaces for that? I'm showing the slide. District Hall is a building that was supported by public and private money in South Boston's Innovation District. I happen not to be a big fan of the physical quality of South Boston's Innovation District, but this is really one of the only spaces where people come together. There are workspaces you can take over for the day. There are workshops going on all the time. But this kind of space within both districts, whether they're galleries, whether they're meeting spaces, this is for this kind of thing, happen in both places. You need those kinds of collaborative spaces that also connect people in what I call third places, the term that's used in planning. Those places that aren't planned. They're not work, they're not school, they're not home. They are the third places where the public comes together to connect. And those are very common between arts and innovation districts. Where do you have those places, the serendipity of life, and the connectivity between all of them? And diversity. So as much as I'm not a big fan of the public realm of the South Boston Innovation District, if you look at the diversity of businesses, from financial services to high tech, to graphic design, to architects, to artists, there's a lot of mix within that, and that creates a very rich environment. And diversity is one of those key pieces. And again, this mix-up. Anchors, kind of large anchors, for-profit institutions, nonprofits, small uses, a real mix of things that come together in the way that cities grow organically. And these tend to also be part of the success stories. Put this in toward the end, but it's very important, this idea about serendipity and delight. And it tends to be missing from a lot of innovation districts, which is why here in South Bend there's such a great opportunity to look at how the two come together. Because of the arts presence here, there is this notion of serendipity and delight. This was a welcome new addition to the South Boston Innovation District, the D Street, calling it an adult playground, which
these lighted swings and such that people come to, they play ping pong. It's on an area where the convention center is going to be expanded. But it's looking at, and people love to go there, and it's really one of the bright spots in a rather kind of very neutral corporate environment in South Boston. A lot of fun. And some other examples of, you know, a basketball tree sculpture, you know, rocking chairs for adults. Fun things that you don't expect. But get people talking in a different way, but create third places for people to come together. And then the intensity and density of uses, kind of the kickstart investment that goes into them, are common characteristics of these places. Along with coordinated efforts for programming, marketing, all of those things, there needs to be some umbrella organization, someone taking that on about business recruitment, or in the artist case, looking at marketing, looking at how spaces are allocated. So we have some common characteristics. It's a long list. But I think the important thing here is to look at all the commonalities between them, and then some unique things about art spaces here in the blue, around what kinds of spaces. Innovation districts tend to be about production, producing new knowledge, producing products. Artist districts need three different kinds of spaces to succeed, and I'm going to talk about those in a minute. And affordability. Well, affordability is important for startups and incubators. It's critically important for most artists in order to produce their work and sell their work. And space for organizations and consumption, galleries. How do people, and consumption is kind of a technical term, but how do you buy art? How do you enable artists to thrive and to live? So what should we be thinking about? I'd like to frame this in our discussion today by thinking about, I'm going to show some success stories, we can talk about models. I'm a firm believer you do like the success stories, but you don't be like them. The South End is unique. So the solutions here and how we move forward is going to be about what the South End is. And it's going to be multi-pronged. It's going to take a lot of different organizations, different capacity within the community, different people, different kinds of spaces, different models coming together to make this work. There's no one solution to how it works. And I also think there needs to be a clarity. So the best examples are ones where people can define, what do you mean by affordable? How do we define an artist? What's a maker? You know, in some way, we don't want to box everything in. But knowing what we're aiming for and what this means is important. And I'd just like to say that, you know, change is a fact of life. And we have seen so many districts really be victims of their own success. And thinking about how to be proactive and getting out in front, reactive, never works. So I think that is a good thing why we're here today. I would also say the common elements in all of these stories as we frame this discussion about how to get where we want to go. Strategic action cross-sector. Government, for-profit, non-profit, artists, entrepreneurs, residents, everyone gets involved to make these things work. They don't necessarily all agree, and some of them are working on some projects and others, but this whole idea about collective action, it's always place-based. It really has a core of creative and innovative and maker spaces, and again, this diverse coalition and artists engaged in the community around a variety of spaces. And I want to talk about variety of spaces before we get into the panel, just for a moment. There really are three types of spaces that are critical to support an arts and cultural community. They're the spaces of production. Do you have a place? Do you have a studio? Can you be there? Can you work? Is it suitable for what you need to do? Is it affordable? There are spaces of consumption. How do people come and see what you do and buy work, to be exposed to art, how it can contribute to life, to livability, to kind of our place in the world. And then there are the places where there's this interaction between the public and private bodies, between artists, between innovators, between makers, that encourages a kind of knowledge and understanding that creates an environment of sustainability and mutual respect. And those spaces also have to be present. Artists just working alone in production places without a connection to world and visibility, it's very hard to sustain those places over time. And affordability has a lot of different models.
And that's important because a lot of different avenues to get where you want to go. There's for-profit private development, where developers may, because of regulatory requirements, have to set aside a number of units or workspaces for makers, for innovators, for artists. There are artist-owned co-ops and buildings. Individuals sometimes buy buildings and figure out how to make it work. For-profit, non-profit. And there's no single type of artist space. There are different needs for spaces at different points. And that's why it's so critical here to have a market study. And the city is just about to undertake doing one. When we say artist space, what does that mean? When we say affordable, what does that mean? The market studies I've worked on have shown a wide range, a really surprising range of what artists need for space, but also what they're willing to pay for space. And that's important to know because then the development community can use that information in terms of how do we move forward. And I'm just going to go through very briefly a few examples of what some of those spaces might be in collaborations. I'm using the Station North Arts District of Baltimore, partly because a former student is head of that organization, and I'm really proud of what he did, but also because it's an example, I have a couple of other places in here, it's an example of how a lot of different approaches and different kinds of development have happened in one place to help support a very vibrant community. There is a project that just opened there called City Arts, which is artist work live space. That's very mainstream. And this was a combination of mainstream developer and manager and a funding collaboration to make this work. Very different than what you would see from a typical kind of artist development. They're set aside here for affordable units. That's a typical unit. That's a kind of typical unit here. Most of them are studios or one bedrooms. Great views, lots of amenities. There are some artists who are not comfortable being in that kind of space. But it works, and it adds to the diversity of the district that's there. There's also a number of buildings in the old Cork Factory complex. The actual Cork Factory building is an artist-owned co-op, so artists came together to make that development happen, and then got the technical assistance and kind of learned how to put that together, how to get other artists in. They own it, they control it. So there's a bit of sustainability and safety in that, I would say. And another building in that complex is owned by one individual. And he's trying to figure out how to create sustainability and affordability in the long run, perhaps when he isn't even here anymore. And so he has created a number of open public exhibition spaces. And then he did this wonderful photo essay on all the artists in the complex. He's very good at marketing this project. But thinking about how to sustain this in the long run, you know, this is a labor of love for this fellow. And then some individual artists got together. It's not a co-op, but they own the building together in Area 405. There are six artists that have been working for a really long time and struggling around things. The city wasn't able to give them the permits they needed. They're learning the ropes. This has been an ongoing process for many, many years. But this is, you know, individual artists who come together with no development experience and they're kind of shooting for this. And it's working. This is a project in Providence that I love because an arts organization, nonprofit arts organization, took on AS220. They got an initial loan from the city, which gave them credibility to then go to other lenders and say, we want to put this together. And how they made this work is that it's in a pretty good part of town, and so the ground floor retail really helps support and subsidize the rest. They've created a kind of buzz around food uses, and they've been doing this for over 10 years. Some great restaurants and destinations that they've created, almost a whole revitalization of the community around these two buildings. And how they did it, they really worked a deal with the city and that the initial build out to get their certificate of occupancy was bare bones, literally a sink and a toilet. They didn't have things like even stoves or ovens which were required for a certificate of occupancy, and worked a deal and allowed the artists to finish off those units. So artists were able to come in at a very low level and do the work themselves. Units are really bare bones, but there are artists who want that and need that. So it's a great success story. Lots of programming and connections with the community. And the last one is something that was done by partner on a lot of projects I do, Peter Roth at New Atlantic Development. Midway Studios is a major artist building. It's about 86 units of live workspace in Four Point Channel, and almost, I guess about 36 of them are set aside for affordability for artists. Long-term developer in Boston, did a lot of affordable housing, had a real soft spot in his heart for artists. He passed away, and the estate decided they had to sell this building. It had a loan from HUD for some of the other affordable units in the building. He started getting offers of $25, $30 million in the building from developers circling overhead. The artists were, it's the worst nightmare, right? The artists have been in this building for a long time. They came to Peter, the for-profit developer who does a lot of this kind of work, and said, what are we going to do? And in a week, they did a kind of crowdsourcing and raised $800,000 from friends and family and interested individuals in the community. And this is not, this is not a wealthy group of artists, but they were able to reach out to everyone. And when they went to the estate, the lawyer for the trust, and said, we've got this, by that point, all of the publicity around raising that money made them really take notice. Well, if the artists can pull this much money together, what can they do? And they worked on a package deal. They did an offering. They did a kind of limited private offering for $4 million in loans. Peter was able to renegotiate the loan with HUD and to keep it through the transfer of ownership, which is really unheard of. The whole deal from start to finish was 6 months. And they transferred ownership over. It's run by a board of directors. Peter and the development company controls half of the board seats, and the nonprofit organization that was formed controls the other. He manages the building because he's very good at managing and keeping things tight. Real success story, and they're renting out the ground floor spaces for retail and other uses. So a new kind of model that hadn't been seen, and really collaborative. So I'm going to move past that.
Was that set up as a limited partnership?
It is. So the investors are expecting to get their money back. Yeah. And I can get you more details on that, or a phone call with Peter. He's really excited and proud of it, and working on a full case study right now.
Nice.
So the takeaways, I think, for a lot of the success stories is that change is inevitable one way or the other. The most successful cases are ones where people are aware of it, they become knowledgeable about it, and they kind of grasp it and make it work in the way they need to. All of these districts take a variety of incentives, public incentives, kind of private efforts, private fundraising, financing sources from a lot of different places. Some of the typical artists' affordability, you know, projects might have 6, 7, 8 sources of financing to make them work. And identifying the tools, the capacity of the stakeholders is key. There are a lot of different things that can be done. You know, whether it's trying to get flexibility around codes and regulations, developing technical assistance, or pairing successful developers with ones who want to try it to help with technical assistance, looking at tax incentives, eligibility requirements around income for artists for affordable space. The assumption that all artists can't afford market rate space is actually erroneous, and so trying to really earmark space where artists really need it to support that community. All different kinds of things can happen to make it work, and it's going to take a lot. So I'm going to leave it there. And what I'd like to do is bring up some folks who've agreed to be in a discussion, maybe a panel that's too formal or whatever, to talk about experiences and they've had with developing it or want to or managing it and what some of the challenges are and possibilities. Can you come up if you agree to be?
We're going to just start with introductions.
So I'm Eric Hoekstra. I'm a partner at a company in town called Redstone. I'm a real estate developer and have been in the real estate industry for about 15 years. And actually that Midway Arts project that Susan talked about in Boston, 15 years ago I worked on a planning effort to create the Midway Arts District for Beacon Properties. It was cool to see that, and that area has changed dramatically.
And I'm Steve Conant, and I've run Conant Custom Brass, now Conant Metal and Light, in the South End for 33 years. I've been a landowner down here for 32 years, and I own and manage the Soda Plant, which is sort of the north end anchor of the arts community.
I'm Michael Monte. I'm the Chief Operating and Financial Officer for Champlain Housing Trust, which has its headquarters in the King Street neighborhood. I'm a South End resident, lived in the Five Sisters for about 30 years or so. I used to be the director of the King Street Youth Center. I think my whole life has been on Pine Street for the most part.
I'm James Unsworth. I work for Unsworth Properties. We're a family-owned company that has owned and managed property on Pine Street for quite some time. I'm sort of the fourth generation to be working in some of these buildings, so that's pretty cool. I'm relatively new to the game, but I've enjoyed, you know, coming in and learning as much as I can over the past, only 9 months, but, you know, working to push our space forward and try and help with this project.
I'm Rich Aronson from AO Glass, and I'm a very happy tenant of the Unsworth family. They've been very supportive and provide a really great, affordable incubator space. And I'm also here too because I'm one of those makers that people talk about in the artists, but also someone whose business is starting to grow. So I feel like I have a good perspective on the different ends, and I've actually had some success reaching out to different private individuals in order to help grow the business. So I'm really here to promote a we're all in this together mentality.
Well, you sort of represent the all of us together. I'm just going to shoot a basic question out. For those of you who've done it, you're managing property, or you've created artist space or affordable space, what are the challenges? What are the challenges you've had, and what do you see moving forward?
Good question. I think that one of the challenges might be resisting the opportunity to profit as a landowner.
Yeah.
And another would be that to run a business and be the manager of the property and keep all those balls in the air adds another layer, but it adds a level of flexibility that's extraordinary. When you describe the artist-owned space, that would be where I work, and it's an extraordinary opportunity. I think supporting those tenants who are growing, you hate to see them go when they grow. And you want them to grow, and so that's an interesting challenge, just sort of somehow embracing their growth, and but not knowing where they're going to be, and being able to help that is a challenge.
I think we're running out of like funky old cheap buildings to do stuff with in Burlington. That's our biggest challenge. And you know, the buildings that the Unsworths own, and the building that Steve owns, you know. Those, like James's family, has owned that property for generations now, and so their basis is very low, and you know they've been able to make things work for artists there because of that. Steve bought the building 32 years ago.
15. For the Soda Plant, 15, but still long enough ago.
But long enough ago. Yeah. So, you know, when we look to try to create new opportunities in the South End or anywhere in the city. And have to figure out how to acquire property, renovate or build something. It's very hard to do that and then end up with something that would be perceived as affordable for artists and makers and startup businesses and everything else. You know, we get really creative about it. We've done projects that include, you know, a dozen sources of creative capital and tax credits and all kinds of crazy financing, and that can get you some of the way there, but those sources of funds are in very, very short supply, and oftentimes only apply to certain geographic areas like the west side of Pine Street and not the east side of Pine Street, things like that, that make it incredibly challenging.
You know, I never really feel challenged enough. I just think that. Sorry.
Oh,
no,
we have a
sorry. No, I do think that there's nothing easy about anything that people are talking about wanting to do in terms of great commercial or office or affordable spaces for artists. that are going to reflect the things that these two guys can do with those spaces. I think Eric did it by the way. But I still think that there's always sort of some, there's an unlimited capacity, mostly in Burlington, it seems, or perhaps in other places, to figure it out and to work together to make things happen. So I see that a lot. I see that if there's a will, there's an opportunity. And I think that the challenge becomes something that you break down into achievable places and parts, and you move forward. It may not be that the whole South End reflects, you know, something that's perfect. And I think these two spaces are near perfect, right? My son has a studio in your space, and I want it to be forever.
Yeah.
So I don't think we're going to be able to achieve that cookie cutter throughout the South End. But I think we're going to be able to. We can go ahead and recreate and do some additional things or to solidify the work that these guys do in some way. So,
what would, for any of you, what would you envision that being? If this is these are the bookends of kind of the perfect, and these buildings have been in, you know, 15 years for your family generations, what, in your experience, what would it look like in the current South End to try to secure or to do a project or a piece of a project or a collaboration? Any thoughts about what that would look like going forward? A new version of the South End Perfect or a South End Solution?
Well, I guess for our space expanding, you know, obviously looking at cost, it could be a prohibitive factor for, you know, doing any expansion. The zoning and stuff like that in our area is also prohibitive. You know, we're a very high density space and there's a lot of restrictions, most notably over parking spaces. And we don't really have the ability to do that right now. A lot of our spaces are sort of grandfathered in. So for us moving forward, we would certainly need, you know, some flexibility from the city in terms of that to do any expansion. You know, cost also being a major factor, but I would say just in terms of overall spaces that we have there is a major issue.
The planning department is here, so you can say that again.
Yeah.
I'm going to repeat that a couple times.
Yeah.
I think, you know, the challenge, like I said, is that there aren't very many funky old buildings left in this area of town or any area of Burlington that haven't already been repurposed and reused in some new productive way. There's a handful of buildings I can think of in this Pine Street corridor that, you know, may present an opportunity to be reused in a different way, but there really are few and far between. So then you start to think about, you know, opportunities for infill on sites that are underutilized, open, you know, parking lots, things like that. It's beyond challenging to build a brand new building ground up and subsidize it enough to make it affordable. It's possible, and like Michael said, you know, anything's possible if you have a committed enough group and a vision. I think the other piece of it that I think about, and this goes to sort of your proactive, you know, sort of mantra in your presentation, is like, you know, if we have creative, affordable artist spaces that are working right now, you know, what can the community, what can the city do to work with those property owners to now stabilize those properties? And you know, I think, you know, private property owners have some expectation of making some money along the way. So, you know, they shouldn't just do it because they're good people. I mean, maybe that's part of it, but, you know, is there a way that you can make it worth their while, but also preserve that space for the next 30, 50, 100 years?
So I think these spaces were initially created on Pine Street when Pine Street was on the edge. Really, really had, it had no value. Right. If anything, it was seen as the wreckage of Burlington's economy because these places had moved out of town, and now they left these abandoned buildings with very little opportunity. The question will be is for, as a new developer, where are the spaces that are on the edge now on Pine Street, and could we carve out some of those spaces enough to be able to recreate some additional buildings? But it's not going to be wholesale right in the middle of something. It's going to have to be back a little bit in a way. And I'm speaking in sort of visual terms and clay terms, but I think the point is it's we're not going to be on Church Street. You know, we're going to have to be
and the edge is on Sears Lane, and the bank is going to have to be there. We've got to work through some of those issues and incorporate the challenge of building on that site into the affordability and opportunity. So, you know, so if I was to sort of be a developer picking places where I might do something, it's going to have to be there, and that's those spots.
I think that's a really important point, is that, you know, a lot of what we have that's funky and cool and affordable was created at a time when Pine Street was on the edge. And you look at a lot of the examples that you talked about in Baltimore and Providence and Boston, a lot of those areas were on the edge when those things happened. When I was working on, you know, the Midway Arts District, Four Point Channel 15 years ago, that whole area had been cut off by a highway until the big dig happened in Boston. So for decades, it was not a place you wanted to be, and it was a place that only artists would put up with. Then the big dig happens, buries the highway, opens it up to the rest of the city, and suddenly it's a place that everybody wants to be. And that's kind of what has happened here in Burlington with Pine Street as well. It was crappy 30 years ago. Now it's the place everybody wants to be. So how do you deal with those dynamics?
And that's certainly, I mean, that is the gut-wrenching fear of the artists who are here now, right?
Sure.
Is that any change is going to follow with every, you know, every arts district in the country. You know, artists are urban pioneers. You come in, you know, you create a space. Sometimes I had friends who were squatting in those buildings, the Four Point Channel. I would go to, you know, them, they didn't have running water some of the times. And now, you know, then they're priced out. And so thinking about how to protect what's here, but also perhaps grow it a little, or at least create some sustainability around this arts community and allow others to come in. You know, what I'm hearing is, you know, obviously maybe not a whole project. What do you think about, you know, carve-outs, a piece of project, incentives to get, you know, 5% of something, 10% of something? How realistic is that?
I'd like to speak to that whole, like, okay, so we've got the gut-wrenching fear of today and holding on to what we got. And then there are the trends in the economy and commerce. 30 years ago was a speck in time. And there was an opportunity because something changed and manufacturing became less viable. And right now it's really exciting because high tech is a big deal, and there's all this great dealer.com and innovation stuff in office cubicles. But what's it look like 30 years from today? And the trend I see, of course, it's a vested interest in it, is the maker trend of manufacturing coming back and the actual, like, hands-on. And so I don't know, you know, back 30 years ago, we didn't say, whoa, there's this huge opportunity for the arts, so let's do, well, the Pine Street Arts Association, we did that, but it wasn't this, like, look at what this whole district can be, but now look what it is. I think we have to be really cognizant of what's this district going to be like in 20, 30 years, and not make sure we don't throw out any baby that might grow into a different adult that we don't even recognize. So.
Any thoughts about that, or what that approach would be for you or anyone?
You can't, I mean, it's hard to predict the future, but the one I see is that the need for industrial, like get or done type space is growing rapidly. And I think it's an integral part of a community to have that. We don't want people driving to Williston to go do their work. And so that we need to support that chunk of the mix, I think, in a big way.
Or as these businesses grow too, looking forward, you know, I think of Steve's building or the Unsworths, there are plenty of people that have growing businesses that can afford space, you know, at somewhat close to a market or realistic value. So as more manufacturing does come back, there might be opportunities to develop buildings that actually are self-supporting financially because of those businesses. One question I have, though, it's, you know, we talk a lot about maintaining these spaces. I'd really like to know how many, you know, it'd be interesting to see that market research, how many people do want to have spaces and what are they willing to. I think that's a really crucial part of the puzzle. And I do see, you know, like Terry, Zygmunt and I, for example, we rent space at the Unsworths, and Steve has a tenant, run Space Gallery, there are opportunities for people who are maybe a little more entrepreneurial to take on larger spaces and then carve it up into, you know, relatively small places and still generate the income needed to support that as well. So
I think, you know, you asked a question about incentives and requirements in terms of regulations, and I think, you know, our experience working in Burlington is that truthfully it is almost impossible to get anything done and have it be economically viable without extra requirements. So I'm a much bigger proponent of incentives versus requirements. And I don't know what that looks like, but you know, if there's a goal to have a certain amount of space set aside as affordable artist maker space, whatever, however you want to define it, I would rather see that tied to a development incentive than make it a requirement, because if you make it a requirement, it's going to be even harder for us to get anything done in this district. So, you know, maybe it's a parking waiver, maybe it's a density bonus, I don't know. There also, we've had other consultants come to Burlington and make suggestions about incentives that don't work here. For instance, property tax relief. Very difficult to pull off in Vermont because the state of Vermont controls 2/3 of our property taxes. So Burlington doesn't have that lever to pull on very, very much. You know, we have two existing tax increment financing districts in Burlington. I think it's beyond a long shot to expect that we could get a bigger or additional TIF district in Burlington because the legislature is so vehemently opposed to the creation of new TIF districts or expansion of existing TIF districts that, to me, that's sort of like, try, sure, but you're probably not going to get it, so don't count on it. And I, you know, there's not a whole lot else out there in terms of economic financial tools, so it really becomes, you know, more of a, you know, what can you do for sort of land use bonuses, I think.
Do you think of other incentives? You know, I heard parking from James, you know, the parking requirement. Other things that might make it interesting or viable?
I mean, it just gets difficult, especially in our space, because it is so old, and, you know, any time that we would try and do anything, I mean, we're just going to really feel the crunch in terms of, you know, city codes and stuff like that, which I completely understand. I mean, for us, it just gets very difficult keeping up with these older buildings and not having to, you know, go for a major redevelopment project, and then all of a sudden it does become cost prohibitive for us to, you know, supply affordable artist space. So really, any incentive that the city would be able to give us in order to either upgrade spaces or expand spaces, stuff like that, would be, you know, very much appreciated.
I think Eric is probably one of the smarter private developers when it comes to sort of the variety of financial resources that are out there. He's done this in other work historically. CHT does that. My organization does that quite a bit, and I do think that there are more limited resources than there have been at times in the past, or at least there is lines that have been drawn on a map that make it more difficult to access these resources. I do think, though, that
can
it's...
Can you explain that?
The line on a map, the resources,
yes.
Well, it's part of what I said, access. you know, this is most of the programs where there are opportunities are either based in federal or state government. The TIF district has a very clear boundary, and the TIF financing doesn't come back to Burlington unless it goes through a state approval process. And a lot of the TIF money that is being used is school property tax money, and the state is not so easily wanting to give that up. I was involved in creating, I did the first TIF district when there was no rules. It was great. Great. And then I was involved in Burlington. On the waterfront and in parts of downtown. And then later on, when the new legislation, I came and fought for the new legislation, I was like banging my head against the wall about how difficult it was to get folks in the state to think this had value. But I think, so that's one rule. New market tax credits is another one where there are boundaries where, you know, King Street, like we have three buildings right in a row that all use these tax credits that the federal government makes available for people to invest in private property that have some public benefit. Our office, King Street, uses the hotel, all use that. I think it ends at King Street. Then it's gone. It's gone.
It goes down Pine Street, but it's only on the west side.
For
and the availability of what they consider metro area allocation is insanely limited.
Yeah.
And nobody outside of the state of Vermont that has any metro allocation wants to work with us.
So there are some other tax credit programs and stuff like that. And what CHT has 350 buildings and 60 different partnerships that we are engaged with using both new markets and low-income housing tax credits. We have a variety of different corporations we control. If you looked at it in a paper, somebody would go, oh my God, these people are criminals because they're hiding something. We're just simply taking advantage of the tax code and basically in that context, taking private sector money, using it to buy buildings, allowing those buildings to become more affordable to folks who are using it. We did that with the Rose Street Co-op. And I think that there's an opportunity potentially for folks to come together. That tax credit money could become available for instance, if there was an artist co-op that wanted to do residential kind of work. They actually, as a co-op, still functioning very well. They have some decent spaces in there. It isn't make and break kind of stuff. I like to use the word break after you use make. It's because make sounds so nice and sweet and break sounds a little loud and obnoxious.
Yeah.
Right?
And
sure. You do both, don't you?
You do both.
Just to be clear about that to everybody else. So they have some spaces where they can make and break things, but I think that, so there is opportunity, I think, perhaps in a tax credit partnership that has some limited money to do something where folks can come together as a co-op, be residents, and also have some common space where they're doing some stuff. And that co-op is decently successful. We have one person in our organization who's just organizing co-ops, doing one on Bright Street right now for 42 units. That's not going to be artists. It's just simply going to be Old North End. But I think that might be something that could be done. That's a potential leverage of resources. It really isn't in the residential section, not in the commercial section as much. On the commercial section, the only things we've done is, because we are a nonprofit, we've sort of done some deals with private owners that allow them to get cash flow and not pay capital gains and do what would be a gift.
Michael, you need a fedora and a black suit. And
yeah,
I'm making these deals.
He has what I believe in.
I have something like that. But I mean, these are things that are common things. As a nonprofit, we might be able to do better. We've partnered with Eric in the past. We've partnered with the other Eric. We only partner with Eric.
I have a question about management, the whole idea of co-op. In looking at my work nationally with about 150 kind of arts organizations and affordable artist space, one of the recurring problems often isn't getting the space. You know, artists get a building, they're going to renovate or, you know, do something. It's, you know, securing the financing, it's doing all the things to fit out a space, and then it's the management of the space, which I think you put it, actually, Steve, when you said to be the owner, manager of a space and also kind of be someone as a maker, those two things often don't fit together for artists. Just in your experience of the projects you've done where there's a co-op, or maybe talk a little bit about the kind of skills you need and what capacity you see in the community to make that
I'll
happen.
I'll speak from personal experience, yeah. Because 8 years ago, I downsized my business and ended up with some bigger than this warehouse space. And I was a landowner, and I knew it could be put to good use. I had a personal interest in rebranding the soda plant as a creative sort of mecca. But to get that filled, I was either gonna fill it with something fairly big or make it available. And Christy Mitchell, who runs the space and gallery, was my employee at the time. And she said, hey, how about I quit and rent that from you for warehouse rates and turn it into artist space? And so suddenly I had a singular tenant who was willing to bring vitality to the building, pursued the build out on an absolute bare bones, 2x4s and some sheetrock with some code challenges, but got that done. And has done an extraordinary job keeping my life simple for that end of the building. And I think that, and it's fine for me if she makes a profit or a livable wage, and she is making space available. And our challenge is making sure that we are still the affordable, aren't at the high end. Just think about it though, as things improve or artists' lots improve or whatever, they like amenities. So we paint the wall, or we do a little patching, or we fix a bathroom, and before you know it, it's kind of neat there. Those all cost a lot of money, typically. And then you end up with shinier space. I've had probably 4 phone calls in the last week for rough and ready break-in space, and it just ain't available. And so, even an artist space can gentrify. I mean, even Howard Space is nicer than it was 30 years ago. I thought I turned that off. So anyway, that's worked really well for me, and I'm not interested in collecting all those little rents, or paying a manager to do that. So in effect, I'm renting to a singular tenant, and I like that model.
Collecting those little rents is a lot of work.
And chasing artists? Man.
No offense. No offense. They're frisky.
No offense, because I'm one. But no, it's just, it's a different, and it's so, the conversation I've been having with her is really interesting. The difference between a tenant who moves into a high-end space is like a residential tenant moving into a snazzy apartment. You know, you see a mouse and it's the end of the world. And that's a very different type of tenant to space to manage, level of expectations. And so our conversation is, wow, what, you know, artist space is one thing, but there are strata of artist space. And I think there's probably a critical mix that we need. And I'm not sure we've done that inventory yet to say we need 20% rough and ready. Oh, we got it in those 4 buildings. How can we hold on to that much inventory of rough and ready? So that whole, and then it goes city-wide. So we need housing. Right now it feels like this huge threat for housing. It's like going to take away all the art. But what if development happened in such a way that we attained those, whatever it is, 2,000 units, and it looked like it didn't necessarily need to gobble up this building or something? You know, maybe we can let down our guard a little bit with a little more strategic mix of what we believe we want.
Any other thoughts about, I mean, the co-op?
Good things. There's always an operating cost for anything. And before you even build a building, it's going to cost, you know, $500 a month to operate. It doesn't really matter. You know, just there's always a number that says you pay taxes, you pay the maintenance people to come in and fix some things, you put money in reserves, you make sure you have a cushion, you take care of vacancies, all of those things I thought about. Well, whenever we do budgets, it's always a development budget and an operating budget. Operating budget has to make sure that development, when it's over, is successful. And I think that's, you know, what we have seen is when the co-ops are involved, they take a little bit more time in terms of governance and thinking about things and talking to each other, but their operating costs tend to be a little less in terms of management. We always provide a certain level of sort of financial sort of oversight to basic things, just to make sure that the people who are mortgaging the property are getting the right reports and the audits are correct and all that. But that's a sort of at the very high level, and then folks get involved and say, how do we work together to make things happen? And it's really about the success of the cause. We've had, if you know, Park Place downtown, right on the City Hall Park, where Monstream Studios and those buildings was once a co-op, and we dissolved it because it could not function. They're great apartments now, and great little studios and other spaces, but that co-op simply could not work. But we have other co-ops where the costs associated with management are very low because they do some self-governance work that works.
I'd like to open it up for questions, but before I do, because you have an audience of the city here and the planning team is here, if there's something you want to say you haven't said about it would be great to have this incentive, or I don't want the parking requirement, or don't release all the code, I'd really like to go through and talk about your wish list, or even if it's a bit pie in the sky, for each of you and your experience, so we can kind of hear that, and then I'd like to open it up for questions, because I know there are people out there ready to go.
We all get one.
Can I start with you, Eric?
Yeah, I guess, you know, my overarching theme for planning and zoning in Burlington is flexibility. And, you know, I think that we overthink our zoning and planning ordinances a lot. And we try to anticipate every possible little iteration of what could possibly happen and what we fear the most and don't want to happen. And we end up with an ordinance that's so cumbersome and has so many inner conflicts within itself that you end up not being able to do much. I think some of the work that David and Sandrine are doing right now around form-based codes is a good concept. My fear is that because we are endless tinkerers and overthink things as a community, that we're gonna end up with something that is, excuse my French, but a bastardized version of a form-based code that doesn't really work.
My overarching interest is that we maintain commercial industrial, as much inventory of commercial industrial as we can project we might want in this corridor later. I think the flexibility is important. I don't see an improved space going back to being rough and ready. And so that whole, I think it's the rough and ready sector that suffers the most likelihood of going away completely. And so I think that's most critical to support, protect.
These are two good ones. I think I support both of those. I thought we shouldn't have housing at one point in my life because it would just crush the makers and breakers of things. You know, I'm thinking now that the people who are involved or around the makers and breakers, they need to sort of be regulated. It's the people who are complaining about these things that we have to sort of manage in a different way. Now that sounds harsh, but this industrial work has happened in Pine Street for years. It should continue to be able to be happening as we continue. If we're going to have housing, it has to be appropriately placed and make sure it doesn't just bang up against too much of this make and break stuff. But nevertheless, something that protects those makers and breakers and good stuff that they have to do is the right approach to do this. Because there's just too many times when things have been stopped because somebody, one person's interest, has wrecked an entire community's need and desire. So,
we've already spoken to it a little bit, but just flexibility to be able to expand spaces. This rough and ready space, believe it or not, we still have quite a bit of. If you walk around Howard Space and Maple Works, our buildings down on Pine Street, there's a bunch of underutilized space, and we're just prohibited from doing anything with that at this point, because of code.
Well, there's no one who can break things as majestically.
Billy, you should film that.
Next presentation, all like that, in slow motion now with my iPhone. So I would just encourage, we've been focusing on the South End, but we do live in a larger community. You know, there are spaces down near the Intervale, perhaps, and there's Winooski, and not that I want the South End to leave, or not that I want to leave the South End, but I think it's important to keep in mind that this is in context of a larger community.
I think the following on that, it's such a small community that most of these areas are within walking distance. So it's not as if we miss out here, you can't do it there and still get there from here. I think it's quite different from having to like cross the superhighway to get there or go over a river. I think that's a really important one, is that we're looking at the sort of little space here, but it's the bigger context that can't be forgotten in terms of housing stock or rough and ready stock. Or I think it's got to be, it is the city is the story.
And I have one follow-up question, but it'll be after the discussion. So, questions?
Relating to a couple of things that you said, Susan, about, I think it was the AF-220 case in Providence, you talked about how the artist came in and we can call the low level risk
this be able to be turned into lots of rough and ready space, why would a developer like, I guess it's Netty, choose to do something a little bit more polished, which I didn't really look closely at the plans out there, but I get the sense that they're going to take it up a notch into a more polished kind of space, which is like, I guess what you call the shiny space, Steve. Why would there be incentive to do that? If rough and ready is what people want, and why not just turn, like, you know, let some artists come in here and rough and ready with sheetrock and studs and make it into like an incredibly huge maker, artist, creative space.
So, I mean, I think the answer is it's market-driven. I mean, you talked
it's
about
money.
You
it's
money.
Money.
I mean, this is a building that's privately owned. We heard from Steve that, you know, I mean, we all recognize the right of people to be able to make a profit from what they do. And there is a demand for more than just rough and ready space. So while there are people looking for rough and ready space, even among the artists, there's kind of the notch up or other makers. So it's going to be what the market is.
I think that's part of it. I think I can't speak for Netty, but you know, I have a little bit of a window into how his mind works, and so I think part of it is probably driven by the economics and money, but I think another part of it is that what this was is a warehouse distribution facility. Mm-hmm. And what you're talking about the potential for is, you know, changing that use into artist studios. So that change of use triggers something at the planning and zoning level that changes how the city looks at this space and now says, well, in warehouse distribution, you had 10 people in this building and some truck traffic. Now you're talking about 100 artists, 200, however many. So the parking requirements are different. So now you don't have much of a parking lot here because this property was built out in a way that there's almost no parking here. So now you're talking about having to tear part of the building down to create a parking lot and then reinvest in the building to create the artist space. And what you end up with is something that probably, even if you wanted it to be, isn't very affordable.
If I can add to that, it's our side of the regulatory equation, as Eric just said, but it's also then the building code side because, again, you're adding that many more people in here, so the life safety requirements, you know, jump up several notches. You know, we had our own experience with, we needed a fire inspection to do this, and it's like, oh my God.
It's like every day.
Yeah. But they're also competing the users.
Just say one thing to what Eric just said. So my picture of what artists do is they keep your costs down. If what Steve was saying about Chrissy Mitchell in the Space Gallery, she went in there with spit and polish and made that nice, or made it usable. Like, he didn't have to invest a lot of money. So the artists were willing to invest in their own.
Well, that's not exactly true.
No.
So with all these artist spaces and Art Hop coming up, we were told by the fire department that we couldn't have the density that was projected. And we had to invest like $60,000 in a fire alarm system.
Wow.
We support Resource too in a way that they wouldn't be able to be anywhere else. And they took on Youth Build and built up their educational component and wanted to have students in a room. And our fire alarm system had to be upgraded to that of a public school. And so suddenly it's like, holy shit. But we're trying to do the right thing. And suddenly it's like, there's this big layer of cost. So it's really interesting. Like the smaller the spaces or the more people or the code change, there's a domino effect.
It's not about what the artist will accept. The artist would accept crap, you know, and love it.
Right.
I would love
right.
it. You know, that's the kind of stuff that rougher the better.
So conversely, I was speaking to Christy yesterday, and she said, well, you know, this is one of the best spaces because it's safe. And I thought, well, okay, so she's representing the artists and recognizes that there's a challenge there and there's a value associated with the safety. And so it's a really interesting, so we've gentrified on the safety scale, and there's a cost, And I really, so the question that came out of our conversation yesterday is, what are the values that an artist places on a space? And then how is it natural light, is it safety, is it water, is it noise, is it, you know, what are the values? So there's a whole inventory, once we've even defined artist space, of the values they perceive and the cost to provide those values, and somehow, you know, so it's a complicated.
Yeah.
So when we looked at the waterfront downtown, you start to look at the Burlington landscape from 10,000 feet up, and there's acres of surface parking. And there is, in my opinion, also a lot of land use in the suburbs that's being used just for surface parking. Some of it being underutilized for surface parking just back here. So I wonder if any of you would kind of remark on what the potential is for that and how some changes in zoning might help us not only reuse some of that space for whatever use may fit itself then, but also prevent us from having to create any more.
So you're implying that if there's more inventory of surface parking, then maybe the zoning would not require so much parking in a particular
tight
area?
No, I'm saying
area.
There's a lot of surface parking now, and as you're looking at the redevelopment, any redevelopment opportunities, you would, I think, want to be really thinking about avoiding having to create any more, whether it's required by zoning law or not.
So one of Christie's spaces is more like warehouse, and it's open, and I have the opportunity to, and her lease ran out, I have the opportunity to rent it to somebody else that's a bigger tenant or something, or maybe has more density. And it occurred to me that artists are often off hours. And so we have this parking war on either side of my, it's not a war, but it's basically
it's
stress. And so we have this whole wave of people who show up when people leave work. So there's this interesting dynamic. It would mean, you know, yeah, you could develop that as artist space because there's parking requirements are less or timed differently. But how you know, build that in.
Yeah, go ahead.
I don't see this as an either-or thing. Like, for example, this building we're talking about, of course, it's privately owned. Mr. Nettie's not here. We can't ask him, but this seems like a perfect opportunity to try out creatively, financially, to see if some mixed use would work. And I know in one of our breakout groups the other night, looking at Vision 2, we were talking about over there, in all the parking lot space to build some mixed use thing with parking in the middle and something around it, which sounded really cool. And I guess I'm hearing a lot of no's. You know, I'm a yes person, and like, if there's a will, there's a way. Let's find, you know, I've worked with Eric before. We found some pretty creative ways to get some good stuff done. And there's so much space back there. I don't know what Mr. Nettie's planning to do with it, but parking, I don't know, it just seems like doable, and I'm not sure there's zoning, but that's there for a protective reason, and a lot of places opening up here have done so under current zoning with accessory use permits. South End Kitchen, the, you know, yoga place, the hair cutting place, Arts Ride. So there's got to be some creative solutions. And I again, we can't have this conversation without the owner of the property here, but.
Well, I think frankly that's key, is that part of the purpose of this panel is to draw people together to begin a collaboration and conversation. And so if you're wondering why this space is an artist space, the first step is to call Doug and to say, hey, you know, we're interested in this. What are the possibilities?
Well, I'm not wondering that. I'm just wondering why I'm hearing all these no's.
Let me defend the no.
I don't think it's about necessarily no. I mean, the question that was asked was, what are the obstacles? What makes it more difficult? So I think some of the, at times, the requirements of fire, I mean, we knew
we found ourselves in this situation. I have one person, all he does is work through inspections on all our property, that's all he does.
Yeah.
Okay, and that's an enormous cost. So these things need to be managed. They can be done better so that they're less expensive and less burdensome.
Yeah.
The building could be moved and more creatively used if there were three or four things that might be different about both the permitting and the zoning and the code requirements. And there,
but I think Mr. Nettie, we all know, is a very, very wealthy person.
I don't think we should make this about Doug in this building.
Okay, I'm just
to be fair.
Okay, sorry.
And I would say, like, anyone that has an interest in this building, if you want to talk to Doug about it, I would encourage you to do it. But don't do it in a mob with pitchforks. Do it very sensitively.
I don't mean it like that.
Okay. I wanted to get back to Kelly's question, because no one really answered Kelly's question. So Kelly's question was about underutilized land and surface parking lots all over the place in this area, and she's right. There are a huge amount of surface parking lots and underutilized land around here, and I think there are huge opportunities for redevelopment with a wide variety of potential uses. And the other thing I think there's an opportunity for is to work collaboratively with multiple property owners and the city to look at things like shared parking resources. You know, can we consolidate parking maybe into a parking structure that has a shuttle that gets people around the Pine Street District and maybe even into downtown?
There's a plan for a parking structure between Sears Lane and the railroad right-of-way, which was going to be a shared space, which was going to enable that big surface parking lot to develop. They were going to take a couple of levels, and there was going to be a couple of levels for public parking that was going to serve downtown as well as south end businesses. It was just simply an expensive plan, and a plan that needed some other public resources in order to make it work. And somebody could dig that up, they could see it, and they could, you know, create that. I mean, essentially, I mean, I know we all, in the private sector, I consider myself private sector because I'm a nonprofit private corporation. But in the context of this, we all need a certain level of parking. And the issue is that the requirements sometimes don't match what we need. I mean, ultimately, everybody in the old General Dynamics buildings, they need a certain level of parking there in order to be successful. So we need to create that. We just can't go ahead and build something without having some of that happening. We want less, but it's not like that can't be a wish. That has to be a business plan in terms of what we really have to do. So.
Other questions?
Yes.
Thank you. So first, there were three things I wanted to say. The first is that I know most of you, the five of you, some of you very well, and have for many years. You have a tremendous commitment to this, to the South End, to the city of Burlington, and I know that you are doing everything you can every day to make this city a better place, and I appreciate the fact that you're here. We're working on form-based code in the downtown and waterfront, and what we hear from developers is that they want predictability. They want to know what the rules are so that they can plan and they can invest the money in the planning process so that by the time they get to the reality of moving forward, they know what the rules of the game are. But you can't have complete predictability and have complete flexibility. You can't have both at the same time. So one of my questions is, which do you want more? and the second thing is, I just as a side comment, you know, I would appreciate it if we would try very hard to keep the conversation that we're having today civil and not make it personal. And it's a lot easier to hear one another if we're being professional and courteous and not making this a personal conversation. So, because I know that in the end, we all want the best outcome. Thank you.
I would just like to respond.
I just want to apologize and say I didn't mean it like that.
I just meant to, like, let's lay out on the table the different things we each bring to the table. So I apologize if I offended anybody.
So let's focus on the question.
So I want both, Karen. I want predictability and flexibility, and I think that's what a form-based code could do for us. I think that, you know, it may not end up as flexible as maybe I would like it to be, but I think it can be both predictable and flexible, and some of the flexibility will come with requirements where if I want to go outside the bounds of what's totally predictable, there's a process for it, and I have to go through a review process with the development review board and that sort of typical process that we're used to now. But I think we can do both.
Yes?
So I want to try to tie together a couple of themes that I've heard over the last couple of days and get the panel's reaction, especially picking up on things that both Eric and Steve said. And I'm going to use Somerville, Massachusetts as a sort of, which is a city about the same size as Burlington. I'm also on the board of Generator, and it was where we got the inspiration for Generator was from something called the Artisans of Silence. And in Somerville, which you guys, the fancy team probably know all about. But how big is this building?
I don't know. Larry, do you know offhand?
60,000. Okay, so Generator, Artisan Asylum is in the middle of Somerville in an old industrial district surrounded by residential neighborhoods. They grew from 1,000 to 9,000 to 40,000 square feet within the span of 2 years. In that 40,000, it's an old envelope printing plant, I believe that was. In that 40,000 square feet, so about two-thirds the size of this building, they have about 300 members who come and go. They have about 150 businesses that operate in, some as small as 50 square feet or 100 square feet, and some as with one employee, i.e. the person, the artist, and the artist, the maker. This is a maker space for the building. They double the number of manufacturing businesses, in the city within 2 years. Right? $10-15 million of, like, capital. Of the people who work in that building, fifth or come to classes in that building or come to use the tools in that building, 50% of them walk. So we talked about parking. Eric talked about parking and requirements. And I know from talking to Doug Denny, because Doug calls me when he's like, you know, I need more parking because if I increase the intensity of this, I don't have parking. So, you know, can you give me some of that parking over there on the worker parcel that Michael was talking about? Well, we can't quite, there's not enough there, but shared parking is a good idea. So number one is in response to Steve's comment about the sort of residential component. You know, what can the residential density that surrounds this district support that level of walking to work and expanding shared management? That's one question. One I'd like to get a response to that. Number two is the other thing you were in Somerville is form-based code. George Perkakis, who was up here in December and gave a presentation up at Champlain College. And they have two new districts in their form-based code. One is called the Somerville Fab District. It's a fab zone, fabrication zone. It allows art galleries, artisan enterprise, creative studios, which include cultural enterprises, copyright enterprises, content enterprises, patent industries, culinary incubators, shared commercial kitchen, design and fabrication centers, tools for small manufacturing, fabrication laboratories, do-it-yourself workshops, and live, work, create studios, living in the space that you work in.
Actually, work, live.
I'm sorry, you're right. It's work, live.
That's a huge emphasis George makes. These are work, live units.
So, and there's another district called Brickbuff. This was an idea that we've been kicking around, that in the sort of debate over should we allow housing, should we not allow housing, it's so important to keep the sort of manufacturing piece to this, yet it's so crunched. You know, one of the ideas is, well, can you do both? Can you actually use the value created by housing to actually leverage, to actually create increased amount of incubator and business opportunities? So you only can do housing if you provide a whole bunch more of what we want to do. So it's a sort of win-win. And the great benefit is if you have people living either around the edges or, you know, strategically located in the district, they walk to work. They're not driving to take up a parking space that could otherwise be used as an artist. So it's just something to think about. I'd like to have a reaction.
Are you sure?
Yeah, I think so. Well, I think, you know, we just bought 20 acres of land in Shelburne. We think it would be really cool to build tiny green homes on that land. Mm. We think everybody wants to live in a small home, really tiny places. All on my website, it's my Facebook, it's always, oh, look at this little house, look at this, it's wonderful, you know? And everybody who likes those little houses, they all live in 2,000 square foot homes. And so so we are doing a study which is going to say, does anybody want to buy this stuff? And to me, what I would say right now, and I'll throw in cash into the middle of a pot if you have it. Let's ask everybody who has a business here right now on Pine Street. Let's do a study of every assessment and ask the question of all the people who work there. Where do you want to live? How much could you afford? What kind of size of place do you want to live in? You know, how many rooms do you want? Do you want to grow? Where do you want to move to after you live here? Do you want to live for, you know, those kinds of questions, and then we'll find out whether in fact Vermonters who are different than the people in Somerville or Brooklyn or any of these other sort of denser urban places where you come down out of your building and move across the street and go into another building, like on a regular basis, whether we are ready to do that. Because I want to live there. You know, I kind of do. You know, I'm just a lucky one. And the question is whether everybody else wants to do that. So I think it really needs just a strong market study to find out whether it really works. And then you can do these other things. I think to make it work.
I think that just to interject, if you're doing a market study around artists and what their needs are and do they want work-live, that absolutely has to be extended. It's not just artists about work-live, but it's about other makers and people who are working in the district work-live. You know, what or, you know, how close do you want to be to where you are?
I totally agree with Michael, and I think that that's the important thing to keep in mind is when we look at an example like Somerville, we have to remember that even though Somerville may be the same size roughly as Burlington, it's also 15 minutes from Boston, part of the transit network in Boston that changes that dynamic radically. So how do we apply some of the cool ideas from a place like Somerville to a community like ours? And while we're looking at Somerville, we should also be looking at places like Madison, Wisconsin, Asheville, North Carolina, maybe Boulder, Colorado, that are even closer to Burlington in terms of scale and density and the surrounding sort of metropolitan area. Boulder maybe not so much because it's real close to Denver, but you know, you get the idea.
But I really have money for that study when you're ready to go.
Sweet. You have money? Is that what you just said?
I have money.
Calm down.
We're going to call you this afternoon.
Yeah.
Awesome. Yeah, go ahead.
You guys up in the chairs represent authority and the stewards of a collaborative process. And that's a process that's going to affect the futures of a lot of people who are artists in this area. And that concern is an emotional one as well, not just a practical one that has to do with, you know, rules and zoning, etc. And a few minutes ago, you know, I saw the gentleman in the flag speak over Maggie while she tried to explain her intentions, then employ the phrase model pitchforks from the chair as an authority and a steward of the collaborative process that has a potentially emotional outcome for many people. And I wanted to raise the caution and the suggestion that you seek to maintain a facilitative personality as you move forward, and that may have been an error. And I welcome that Maggie was able to speak to clarify that her intentions were positive and inclusive, but I think that opportunity should have been presented from your direction.
Sorry you feel that way, Jim. It wasn't my intention to offend anyone in the group.
Charles. Just a quick question on the studies that show that manufacturing areas and industrial areas are adversely affected by residencies moving in or any kind of housing. There are studies that show that. And I'd like to have some of your thoughts. It was brought up several times about work-live space and how that can actually be accomplished without opening up, say, a Pandora's box of future influx of housing that would destroy the manufacturing enterprise. So what are your thoughts on that?
I just forgot this one.
Oh, no,
go
ahead.
So I've been adamantly against residential in the South End for 20 years or so. And I've always been on the fence because that's what I do is look at both sides. But always been against it because of that, I think, domino effect or Pandora. So I go down to work at night. I was there at 10:30 last night, and I was pounding on steel and thinking about, okay, so if the upstairs was residential, they would not be happy right now. For years, I opened the garage door to get the fumes out from the blacksmith, you know, from my gas forge, and beat on stuff. Or my employee built an 18-foot tower, and at night and on weekends. We're surrounded by residents. Ironically, they don't complain. Why don't they complain? Because they're low-income residents who don't have this feeling of, you know, entitlement at all. We've been doing it forever. So when we turn on our blower and it goes, nobody complains. But, you know, if a little teeny bit of gentrification in our area will change that radically. And my life of loving work and having the flexibility to make noise and burn and light fires will be over. I have the most amazing loft spaces in the second floor of our building that would make extraordinary condos. What's that?
You could live there.
I could live there easily. View of the lake, creative district. So if zoning permitted that, and I was interested in the return on that, it would be a pretty simple switch. So, you know, I think there may be a place for residential because there's an awful lot of undeveloped stuff that isn't right next door to someone who's pounding on steel. And so that's where my interest is. What's our inventory of rough and ready or whatever that space is that's not conducive to cohabitating with residential? Is there enough? And then what are the other opportunities if we can recognize what sort of inventory we want to maintain? So I'm against residential because I don't want to just come in and change out everything. I'm for it if there's a really intelligent way of looking at how it is that it can cohabitate without undermining that existing inventory of creative, cheap artist space.
If I could add, we could do home ownership or essentially ownership of units through a shared equity model that we have, which ensures that the property stays affordable. So we could, in essence, know that the next person who might own that will be able to afford that, and it prevents gentrification. CHT started out as an anti-gentrification, anti-displacement kind of organization for the old North End. It's still sort of in our blood that way. And that kind of a program and that enables, you know, us to keep things affordable over time. It's not for everybody, but it's for some.
Many of the artists' examples I showed have income eligibility requirements. You have a cap on what you can resell your unit for, so there's no speculation. It has to go be sold to someone who's certified as an artist. Some of them, not all of them. Certainly income eligibility. You know, you show your tax returns. You've got to show your tax returns to get, you know, the property. It prevents gentrification and speculation. Talking on the kind of building process. You had a question.
I'm kind of giving up, but it's back to parking again. I wanted to say two things about, I had to ask a question, and I also want to just say that I feel like in this conversation and the other what I've seen so far, the thing, there's something missing in the conversation. All this parking, car-centric, like, why aren't we talking about improving the transportation infrastructure, about other modes of transportation besides cars? I mean, like, look at this weather that we're having. I'm sorry, I don't want to get on this soapbox, but, like, something's happening to our climate. Why are we so damn focused on cars, parking? So that was just a comment and a question. And the second thing is, I would just like to understand, and I guess from the city folks or whoever can answer this, this whole thing about parking. So dealer.com moves in, my studio's next door, I've been there 15 or 16 years, never a problem parking. Then all of a sudden dealer.com moves in, and all of a sudden they're parking in our parking spaces. The way I understood it, you know, it sounds like there's only a certain number of parking spaces per building. So could somebody explain to me what it is about, like how this whole thing works, and how dealer.com can move in there and only have a certain amount of parking spaces, but now up and down Pine Street is filled with dealer.com cars, and they try to scam on our parking. Like, so how does that happen? How could, you know, so this building is being developed, there has to be so many parking spaces. Like, somebody explain that to me, because I don't get it.
Yeah. So I want to jump in on that a little bit. So I guess a few things. One, I think part of why we've been talking about parking has to do with the planning and zoning requirements and some of the limitations that the current requirements place on redevelopment of properties in Burlington. And, you know, I worked on the redevelopment of 444 Pine, where dealer.com is today, but David might remember sort of how the parking requirements were fulfilled there. I can't offhand, so I can't answer your question specifically about Dealer. But, I think a lot of us are thinking about alternative modes of transportation, and we are thinking about transportation networks, not just cars and not just parking. And we're looking for more flexibility around the requirements for parking to think more creatively about how transportation works in this part of the city and all over the city. But I think the other thing is, I want to ask the audience a question. How many of you drove yourself here today?
It's zero out.
Fair enough. No, I get it. But so part of what we have to do is We have to be thinking about the future and thinking about developing the transportation networks that we need today and 20, 30 years from now. But we also have to deal with the reality of where we are today and what we practically need for parking. And that's where there's a disconnect right now, is what's the practical need for parking and what does zoning require? And right now those things aren't in line. And then the other thing I think is, like, what we're trying to do with a lot of our projects is we're trying to help move the market. And so we're trying to make parking in the city more difficult so that people will ride bikes and take the bus and walk. And so,
however, every winter it is going to be zero out for a long period of time. This isn't like a blip of one
But a
day.
Percentage of people will still walk when it's zero out.
So part of the parking equation, too, is that people are people. So even though Dealer's permit says, okay, I'm going to provide so many parking spaces over here and so many parking spaces over here, people are people, so they're going to find the best place for them to park at any given time. So they're going to park in the street, which is closest. They're going to park in your lot, which is closest, even though they're supposed to park a block away, because parking requires management, too. It's not just, say, you've got to park over here, but we have to manage the parking spaces within the public realm on the street, if we want it to be available for tenants or visitors to those businesses, but we also have to manage the parking in the private spaces. And the other issue, one more point here, is that because all of those employees can't live anywhere nearby, they have to drive, or they have to take public transit. So that becomes part of the equation, is that when we attract new businesses in these areas, that if they don't have affordable, available spaces to live somebody someplace nearby, then they're forced to drive, or they feel forced to drive, unless there are other really easy mechanisms to move them. So that's why we're talking about transportation management and talking about how we improve the transit system, all of those different. So those are all part of the dynamics that drive parking and traffic.
There's a little piece I'm not sure we're talking about or even that gets addressed is when Dealer got their permit to build. There are hundreds of employees more now than there were when the permit went
yes.
through. So if you don't project for growth, then the pain starts to set in. I think until there's enough pain, the human nature is not going to change. So if I can't find a place to park my car when I get there, I'm going to take a different path. And I'm all for that. Make it hard. But I bet Kelly doesn't. What do you think, Kelly?
Sorry.
Well, I mean, David's point is actually we have a huge housing almost crisis in this city where we have 1% vacancy, built 18 market rate rental units in over a 10-year period in Burlington. And David's point is well taken that you've got to park close. One point I want to make is that transportation is going through a dramatic change technologically. All transportation. And think about how many computers are in cars and what you can do with them. Everyone's walking around with a mini computer in their hand. And so when we start to project out 20 or 30 years from now and we think about our transportation needs, we need to remember that world is going to dramatically change in the future. And that's going to definitely have an impact on how people get themselves from one place to another. We know from research we've done that people want to get away from the traditional model of two cars and a family, and they want alternatives. We just, at this point, are still evolving on how we provide that to folks. Our zoning requires a building to dedicate use to parking, and as Eric said, thinking about shared uses of those parking resources is going to be essential to how we manage our land use going forward. You know, in the meantime, David's right. It's a question of convenience, and if it's convenient to pull up in front of your building and park there, that's how people are going to usually almost always conduct themselves.
Sandra?
That's what we need to think about. A lot of ways that can change.
Sandra?
Well, I just wanted to build on what Steve was just saying, you know, with the Vivo.com employees, and there's more and more of them, I think, and Kelly just mentioned that a little bit, that raises the housing question. The reason why they're all driving is there's no housing for them to live in the city. They can't afford to live here, and there's also no housing available. If there was, perhaps they wouldn't have to drive and park their car along Pine Street or in, you know, other lots around there. So that's an interesting question that we've been discussing for the last couple of days, and I think that raises that also. And just another quick point too on what Eric was saying about aligning the sort of the reality of parking requirements with the zoning regulations, and this is something that we've been attempting to do in the downtown. We've been trying to remove minimum parking requirements, and that doesn't mean not providing parking for development. What it means is allowing someone like Eric, who is going to develop a new project, whatever it might be, to figure out what his parking needs really are, and to also allow that sharing of parking between different properties, between different types of uses. So that's what that was sort of meant to be. So it didn't pass the city council, but we'll continue that conversation.
Yeah.
But you know, that's just to kind of build upon that also, and that's where zoning sort of often, yeah.
I just wanted to mention what made me a minor point, but it occurs to me. You have some models, Michael, like limited equity participation or removing a speculative element from the next owner's ability to make profit from that, or some kind of an easement or something like that. I want to separate that from gentrification, because gentrification can occur with or without someone making over a certain level of profit. It happens when people take an interest in their property and then change the way that they relate to their area and their facility. And in an area like the South End, which is becoming gentrified, that's a lot easier to happen, even in the kind of model that you're proposing, than it would be like in the old North End that has a different personality. So I think it's very possible that despite the best intentions of CHT and the fact that it's not going to be an aggressive growth pattern for the next owner and you have income limitations, that can still become gentrified because that's a state of mind, and that would have a bearing on Steve's ability to hammer steel and have a difference in the level of expectation of someone living in that house. So I want to separate the idea of gentrification from the other element, because they're not necessarily related.
Let me say, I appreciate that, but let me just also say that we probably own about 800 units in the old North End.
And you what?
800 units in the old North End. We own between shared equity housing and, right. and apartments. So the old North End remains relatively affordable in part because right. we're so present.
Chicken or egg, you know, I mean,
that's what I'm saying. So
if you had 800 in the South End, and they were acting in a different way, then I believe that more. But I understand.
Yeah.
We're at time. It's 9:30, and I don't know if there's any last comments the group wants to make. We promised you all we'd wrap up at 9:30.
Yeah, I'd like to just say one thing. I really, you know, talking about this building too, I would encourage the artists to embrace their entrepreneurial spirit. Band together, come up with a financial plan, and make a suggestion to any land property owners, for example. I mean, you know, there are still spaces in this building that are available, and if there's a realistic plan for people to share space, I don't see any reason why he wouldn't be open to renting it out to someone who can realistically pay the rent. So I'd say, artist, if you want the space, take the initiative for yourself. Don't expect things to come from above and make it happen just the way artists have been doing it for millennia.
And I think that's a really good segue just for me to make a pitch for 2:00. We're going to be talking a bit in a roundtable about how that would look and move forward, what artists might need in terms of technical assistance and support and partnerships to say we're going to come to the table as a partner, and what would that look like, how to approach what incentives are available and partners and trying to move it forward from speculation, why doesn't this happen, to what can we make happen in all different kinds of ways. And we don't know what that's going to look like yet, but it's certainly going to involve a conversation. And that's what this is meant to kickstart. Thank you very much for coming.
Are you related to Dunn Many again?